Another laudatory aspect of Locke's thoughts concerning education is how he takes up the matter of student attention spans. This is definitely something you'll struggle with in your own teaching. I bet you're struggling with it right now, in fact, as you try to push through this long lecture on John Locke. So, what advice does Locke have for us? Well, he tells us that a teacher must know how to clear kids' heads of other things first in order to get them in a position where they're able to attend to the matter of study at hand. A teacher, therefore, needs to find ways of engaging his or her students. He needs to find something, some hook, that entices them to their studies. Now, back in Locke's day, the way that many teachers dealt with inattention among children was, surprise, surprise, to beat them. But Locke says that beatings don't really work. We've already talked about that. They get a student's attention, sure enough, but the student whose attention is garnered via beating isn't attending to the subject, but rather to the prospect of the beating. The focus is never where it should be, in other words. Not fear, but desire, intrinsic interest, or curiosity is the way to go. This is why Locke writes that the great skill of a teacher is to get and keep the attention of his scholar, unquote. How does one accomplish such a feat? Well, Locke recommends two simple things. First, he stresses how important it is for us as teachers to be able to show kids the usefulness of what it is they're studying. How does this thing matter? What significance does it have in my own life? Does it help me understand something deep in myself or something about the world or other people? Or maybe it's valuable in a more instrumental sense. Maybe if I pay attention and learn this stuff, it'll help me fix my car or design that computer game or improve my volleyball serve. Nowadays in bachelor education programs, we talk about authentic assessment and authentic task design. Essentially, this is what Locke was advising us way back in his day as well. Authentic learning nowadays usually means, at least in part of its definition, making real-world connections and learning. Locke was saying the same thing. The second recommendation Locke has for us as teachers to help our students be more attentive and better learners is found in his stress upon the importance of developing a relationship with the children we teach. Locke writes that the teacher, quote, should add sweetness in all his instructions, and by a certain tenderness in his whole carriage, make the child sensible that he loves him and designs nothing but his good, unquote. These remarks about the need for constant marks of tenderness and goodwill are well placed, ladies and gentlemen. I can tell you from experience that if we're not careful, it's easy to lose this aspect from our teaching. You can become very efficient as a teacher, very effective in your instructional design, very knowledgeable in your discipline. But without attending to this aspect, you and your students will both be unhappy. Sometimes it's so easy and delightful to be with this or that group of students. And students in classes like that will listen to you and each other. And your days together will feel like they matter. And sometimes the bonds that you forge with them will last a lifetime. Other times, you may find that no matter what you do, your efforts to cultivate good classroom relationships are to no avail. Mostly, it's somewhere in between these two extremes, but Locke is correct here. If you ever should catch yourself being unkind as a teacher, just recall your teacher hat that you have donned. Recall that as you were a teacher at that moment, and as you wear that mask before your students, you are empowered to rise above your own impatience or hurt feelings or anger. where in your ordinary life these weaknesses of your own character might infect you and constantly harangue you to defeat, as a teacher, you have this wonderful transformative persona now. I often feel like a bit of an actor on a stage when I teach, ladies and gentlemen. The actor beneath the mask and who wears the teacher hat may not at all be a patient person, or a giving person, or an extroverted social person. But when he wears that hat, he's miraculously able to do and to be all those things to a greater degree. Try it out in your next practicum experience. See if teaching has that effect on you too. See if teaching helps you to be a better man or a better woman than you might otherwise be. Now, Locke's words about the tenderness and the goodwill of a good teacher are certainly intended for the improvement of educational experiences of our students. But why should we also not be beneficiaries of such wonderful practices and habits of mind in our classrooms as teachers? There are many hardships to teaching, but there are also many joys in this transformational aspect of teaching, where we can find ourselves able to be better than we ordinarily are, is just one of the hidden gems. Besides Locke's little essay on education that we've been discussing here, he's also written another short one entitled On the Conduct of the Understanding. I'd like to talk with you briefly about this shorter essay on understanding before moving to his much bigger, famous one called An Essay Concerning Human Understanding. Now, I mentioned this shorter of Locke's writings on understanding because it provides us with some pretty good details about how he thinks we ought to go about practicing reasoning in our classrooms. I mentioned to you in passing already how Locke was really not all that impressed with the practice of having students take formal courses in logic, in critical thinking, and in particular in dialectics. In his view, that's not really the way you learn how to reason well. You don't sit down and study how to form decent syllogisms. You just learn organically, by being immersed in things that interest you, and then thinking about those things in discussion with other people in real, authentic conversations. And really, I think there's much to be said in favor of Locke's opinion here. For let's suppose that you do have your kids strapped into their logic appreciation chairs. Let's suppose that you do get them to display their competencies in construction, an identification of logical arguments and whatnot. That may be an accomplishment, but does it make them any more likely to actually be reasonable people? Put another way, just because you learn the forms of reasoning, does that mean you'll use them when your teacher isn't breathing down your neck to do so? Where's the motivation to actually be a reasonable human being, to love truth, to seek to know the good, to have a distaste for untruth and for lies? I'm not sure that Locke asks these precise questions, but his suspicions around the value of courses in logic and critical thinking do rest upon a basic insight that really what will motivate kids to be better reasoners is being interested and engaged in something that matters to them, and then wanting to know the truth about it, and realizing that reason is the best way to skin that proverbial cat. Not sitting in a boring logic class, going all modus ponens. Another thing that makes Locke rather suspicious of courses in reasoning, disputation, and dialectics is that he associates such practices with sophistry. And on this point, Locke has much company. Perhaps you'll recall from some of our other lectures how in ancient Athens, the figure of the philosopher was often confused with the figure of the sophist, precisely because both the philosopher and the sophist used argumentation and forensic speech. forensic speech is like courtroom rhetoric, you know, where you kind of grill one guy, crush him, and the other guy tries to grill you, and vice versa. You go back and forth, you attack each other with words, right? Arguments and stuff. Anyway, but whereas the philosopher engaged in this kind of back and forth conversational reasoning in order to get at the truth, to find whatever kernel of truth was in this or that statement in a discussion, and to slough off any untruth as so much chaff, taking that truth up towards its ground in a higher, more sublime truth, the sophist, on the other hand, used the same sort of speech not to discover the truth of things, or to know reality as such, but for the purposes of power and victory, to crush his opponents in debate, to win arguments, and generally, to tear down anything that was said regardless of its truth or falsehood. In other words, both used the form of conversational discursive reasoning, but the spirit of what they were doing was entirely opposite. The philosopher's manner of discussion and his loving pursuit of wisdom, Plato referred to as dialectics. But the doppelganger of dialectics, that form of speech that destroys for power, is the sophist's manner of strife-filled speech, known as eristics. That's the word eris in there. That's the word for strife. They had a goddess called Strife in ancient Greece. Sophists, during the time of Socrates, were held in wide suspicion, particularly by the aristocratic elites who saw these wise guy arguers selling their wares as traveling hired gun teachers, who non-aristocratic fathers, if they had scrounged together enough money, might send their own sons in order to them in order to be educated to speak successfully in public forums and in order to engage in more persuasive public demagoguery. So they didn't like that. It was upsetting the apple cart, right? Socrates, you will recall, was put to death by the parents of Athens for corrupting their children with his teachings, with his dialectics. Clearly, they failed to see the fundamental difference between the philosopher and the sophist, let alone between their manners and purposes for speaking in this regard. Let's fast forward to Locke's day. Education had, since classical times, taken on the specific form of the seven liberal arts. These consisted of the three verbal arts, or trivium, of grammar, rhetoric, and dialectic, as well as the four mathematical arts, or quadrivium, of arithmetic, music, geometry, and astronomy. Some notion of a quadrivium had been around, at least since the time of Pythagoras, and the trivium seems to have been first distinguished by the Stoics. All seven were codified by the Latin encyclopedists of the 5th and 6th centuries AD, and then these divisions continued on up through the centuries, occupying much of the history of education. I'm telling you all this because it's important for you to know that even very early on, during the time of ancient Rome, the original meaning of dialectics, as Socrates and Plato had practiced it, was already falling by the wayside. The great Roman philosopher Boethius, I like him, he simplified the meaning of dialectics so that it became a fairly technical matter, just a way of speaking and a tool rather than a specific spiritual manner of pursuing wisdom. In his view, and this is the view that was then passed down through the ages and that dominated liberal arts teaching even into Locke's day, dialectics, now associated with logic, was all about spying out what were the sorts of arguments and manners of argumentation that would always triumph in a debate. Dialectics, as opposed to, say, the demonstrative proofs spoken in discussion of geometry, weren't so much about starting with a set of axioms and then deducing your way to conclusions, like in geometry, right? As they were about compelling an opponent to agree with your own opinions via argument. So really, dialectics were pretty much equated with the eristical speech practiced by the sophists of old, where demonstrative arguments like those of the mathematician were always aimed at sussing out the truth and attaining certainty about what is true. The arguments of dialectics need not be. They can be wholly self-serving. They can be all about power. So, it's this idea of reasoning that displeases Locke in his work on the conduct of the understanding. This is what he would have us steer clear of in schools and in education. Like Jacques Maritain, who, as we've heard from in other lectures in this series, he says that schools and schooling are primarily concerned with matters of the intellect, and only secondarily with matters of the will. Locke, too, writes about the centrality of the understanding and cultivating the faculties of the mind. In his view, the last resort a man has recourse to in the conduct of himself is his understanding. For though we distinguish the faculties of the mind and give the supreme command to the will as to an agent, yet the truth is, the man who is the agent determines himself to this or that voluntary action upon some precedent knowledge or appearance of knowledge in the understanding. Locke therefore emphasizes above all else how important it is for the students to learn how to think, since the depth and quality of their thinking absolutely does have an effect on their willing, a significant point to which we must return later. In his view, students ought to concern themselves not with the ambiguous dialectical manner of arguing for power, but rather with the geometer's demonstrative mode of seeking proofs about what is true. It's precisely this manner of reasoning, what the ancient Romans referred to as ratio, that Locke would have us undertake as the core to the mind's development. Locke begins on the conduct of the understanding by enumerating a number of the different ways our reasoning capacities can kind of fart out. He points to various dangers, such as when we fail to reason for ourselves, but merely obey the rules or the examples set by others, or when we're ruled by our passions rather than by reason in the choices we make, or when we reason incompletely, that is to say, when we don't have all the pertinent facts at our fingertips. Or perhaps our chains of reasoning are okay, but they proceed from a faulty first principle, or rest on shaky ground. Or there are some who, although they read much, and are therefore informed about matters that ought to make them more reasonable, nonetheless fail to make any connection at all between what they read in their books and how they live their own lives. These are the folks for whom reason is more of an abstract cerebral toy and curiosity than a manner of living. These are all dangers with reasoning, right? Things that can go wrong in your classroom. Likewise, there are other folks who take every example they see, every reason offered to them in someone else's manner of living, as though it were a rule, and they follow these diverse routes unquestioningly. Essentially, these folks are too quick to draw a generalization from a set of specifics. Or, there are people who, although they may not mistake the example for a general rule, nonetheless, are only able to see one side of any argument. Contrast these types of people with those who do nothing but collect arguments and points of view, never seeming to give a shit about the truth of any one of them. Likewise, Locke criticizes us when we cut corners in our reasoning, when we rush too quickly along to the end without considering carefully all the processes and details and nuances and things. Still another danger in reasoning, Locke says, is when we allow ourselves to be duped and confused, either by using or listening to empty, jargony words that don't mean anything, or when we use words without really knowing their meaning. Here, Locke speaks more explicitly about the dangers of sophistic, slippery speech that plays fast and loose with the truth. And then again, there are folks who are really great reasoners in one small area of things. They get one area of reality really well. But for whatever reason, that's all they ever seem to be able to see. They've closed their eyes to everything else. Whole vistas of reality and meaning and areas for inquiry. Or else maybe they take their understanding in that one area and they use it as a lens by which to understand everything else in such a way that it clouds their vision of everything else. As you read all these things too, or as you listen to them, folks, like, think of, you know, all these recommendations and warnings Locke makes about reasoning. And, you know, ask yourself, how well does he apply these himself when we get to his bigger book on understanding? Locke, in a certain way, warns about being closed-minded as an inquirer. And he lauds a kind of interdisciplinarity that is hip nowadays in education. And although he warns about being a dabbler, or someone who's professed knowledge that is a mile wide but only an inch deep, he still praises polymathy, or the exploration of knowledge in all the different areas of study and investigation. Well, this is a great long catalog of blunders we might make in our reasoning, ladies and gentlemen. In Locke's view, we learn not to fall prey to these problems of reasoning by practicing and through long efforts at being reasoners. As we've already seen, Locke is big on mathematical reasoning. He loves certainty, and he supposes that real knowledge must be certain in its grasp of the truth. And not just certainty, but exactness. Locke thinks that knowledge, in order to be really knowledge, must be exact. Again, that's why he doesn't like poetry, I think. Poetry exists because poets understand that so much of what is evades and will forever evade exact speech. That the precision that's appropriate to math or to science is not appropriate to other matters and in other areas of inquiry. Locke doesn't have a lot of patience for that, unfortunately. His impatience for such things really comes through when he's discussing the use of similes, metaphors, and analogies as a means of seeking out the truth. In his view, such manners of speaking are okay for explaining things to other people, a bunch of dimwits. They're good rhetorical devices, but they're crap reasoning. They're fine if your intent is to persuade other people to your position, but they're shit if you care about the truth. Here, I think, is an instance of what Nietzsche refers to as English flat-headedness, ladies and gentlemen. Locke enumerates so many ways in which we might fail to reason well, such as supposing that certain manners of inquiry that work well to suss out the truth in one discipline are the only way that inquiry can ever be conducted in any manner whatsoever. And yet, here he's doing it himself. Or likewise, Locke warns us about closing our eyes to entire vistas of reality. But what about here, where Locke demands certainty and exactness in all knowledge and in all manners of coming to know? What about those enormous expanses of reality that you can't know with certainty or exactness? What about those deep aspects of things and of ourselves that we can only explore and think about by means of metaphor and symbol? Locke's flat-headedness is exposed pretty clearly in such things, I think. To recapitulate, then, Locke supposes that mathematical studies are particularly well-suited to teaching young people how to be good methodical reasoners and how to follow a chain of reasoning discursively. he contends sensibly enough that it's the best part, or it's the best to start people out when they're young at good reasoning practices, since by the time they're older, if they haven't done it, it could be a real botch job and very tough slogging. In his discussions of math, Locke stresses how mathematical reasoning is not just good training for youths, it's really the best exemplar of how to reason in everything else as well. Indeed, in his comments on mathematical instruction, Locke suggests that really the deductive reasoning of the mathematician, in combination with cultivating an understanding of probability and inductive practices, collecting all kinds of data and opinions, and then drawing conclusions based on the best evidence available, this best embodies the practice of being reasonable. Anyway, out of all the items up for discussion in his shorter essay on understanding, the one that, for me, stands out most especially is Locke's advocacy for what he calls indifferency. By indifferency, Locke doesn't mean being apathetic or not giving a damn about anything. Remember how Locke tells us that the educator must pay careful attention to what is of interest to kids? No, what Locke means by indifferency is not being so caught up in believing that whatever you think is the be-all and the end-all of knowledge, as though you held the unadulterated truth in your own hands. He wants us to watch out for that. And not just that, he also means a kind of detachment from things. Again, that maybe sounds to you like it contradicts Locke's earlier stated advocacy for interest and engagement in education, but really it doesn't. What he means is, in the classical sense, not to seek the truth out for what it can do for me, not for selfish purposes or with vested interests driving our search, but to seek to know, having put all these things aside, not caring for the outcome of our search, whether the truth discovered helps us and brings us victory, or whether it hinders us from achieving our private desires, whether it foils our best laid plans and ambitions, whether it brings about our defeat even. See, there's a tension here, right, between Locke's concerns with property on the one hand and the idea of curiosity and industriousness and this indifferency business that he's talking about. That's why I like this, because I think it's the better side of Locke we're getting. We simply inquire and we reason in order to know the truth. Period. That's indifferency for Locke. It therefore means not holding too strongly to your own opinions. It requires of us that we be willing to test our own suppositions about things and to plumb the legitimacy of our deeply held principles. Those items we consider axiomatic and foundational in all the reasoning that we build from. These two things, an equal indifferency for all truth on the one hand, and a willingness to examine our own principles on the other, constitutes what Locke calls that freedom of the understanding which is necessary to a rational creature, unquote. Indifferency to all but what is true, in Locke's view, is the best policy. It's nice. In what has been said previously, I have tried my best to give you a fair assessment of the best things Locke has to say about education, and what he can therefore teach us about being good teachers, ladies and gentlemen. And I suspect that you agree with me that there is a good deal that we might affirm in what we have read together in our selections from Locke. However, as with my treatment of Dewey and some of the others in this series, I'm anxious to provide you also with the other side of the story in the second part. Dewey is lauded as a kind of hero and modern-day saint of progressive education. You probably haven't heard too many negative things about him or warnings about him in your B.Ed. classes. So, when I spoke such criticisms of Dewey, I save them for the second half of my lecture in order to save you the grief of becoming disagreeable in social circles, where career-wise it pays to be in entire agreement with Dewey. Here with Locke, in the second part of our lecture, we're on safer ground as we criticize him. He's further distant in time from us, which seems to make him a more acceptable target for modern-day critics. But it's also popular to scorn Locke for his image of the child's mind as a tabula rasa, or a blank slate, upon which we might write all knowledge. The popular image of scorn, promulgated by guys like Paulo Freire, is of the banking model of education. You know, where we, the oppressors, keep our privileged place of authority out of the hands of others beneath us by making them reliant upon us for all knowledge, where we, the lords and masters, make the deposits in those banks that are the minds, or at least the skulls, of our servants in the underclass. Your professors will often talk about the infamous factory model, or the industrial model of education, where each child is sent into the factory, that is the school, to be outfitted in his melon with all the necessary curricular components. All the mandated knowledge, skills, and attitudes will be poured into him. He'll leave the school well-adjusted to fit into the overall machinery of the society at large. Men are, therefore, the infinitely malleable products of our educational techniques, just like wax, waiting for an impress to be stamped upon it. Or, I guess, just like a blank slate, right? And you just write whatever you want on it. That's the idea here. People, they want to link that back to Locke. As we've already seen, that sort of thing really doesn't fit so well with Locke. In his view, human beings are not so infinitely malleable. We do have a nature, eh? And Locke is, after all, concerned with liberty. I don't think he'd see himself like Freire might, as just an instance of the man suppressing the proletariat masses. And just so you know, here's the passage where people locate Locke's tabula rasa idea. Quote, "Let us then suppose the mind to be, as we say, white paper, void of all characters, without any ideas. How comes it to be furnished? Whence comes it by that vast store which the busy and boundless fancy of man has painted on it, with an almost endless variety? Whence all the materials of reason and knowledge? To this I answer in one word, from experience. In that all our knowledge is founded, and from that it is ultimately derived. Our observation employed either about external, sensible objects, or about internal operations of our minds perceived and reflected on by ourselves, is that which supplies our understanding with all ideas we can have, or can naturally have, do spring." Unquote. So, here the knowledge that is written upon the blank slate, or the white paper of the mind, isn't put there by teachers or by the man. It comes more broadly from two sources, one outward, namely our senses, and one inward, namely our own reflective capacities. So much of the tisk-tisking around Locke isn't really that fair to him, inasmuch as it suggests that Locke somehow wasn't respectful of students as real, autonomous, and fully human beings. I think we've seen enough of Locke thus far to know that such accusations against him are untrue. But it's also worth noting, at this point, for all Locke's talk about reasoning, that he's actually not very good at it. Or at least not all that consistent or careful to examine his own assumptions as he would have us do, as a thinker. Any reader of Locke's might, for instance, easily note how all this tabula rasa stuff in his big essay concerning human understanding is pretty clearly inconsistent with his belief in the innate ideas of reason in his other really famous work, The Second Treatise of Government. That being said, I want to now turn to some of the real reasons why we ought to be concerned with Locke's views on education. In particular, I want to focus upon his ideas about what it means to know and to understand. Earlier in this lecture, I quoted a passage from Locke where he says that the depth and quality of our thinking has serious effects upon our willing. Another favorite philosopher of mine is Thomas Aquinas. Thomas wrote voluminously on these two aspects of our soul, the intellect and the will. And he wrote that although it's the intellect that attains to a vision of the highest good and thereby might achieve union with it, it's by the will that we're propelled towards such a vision in the first place, and hence towards our greatest happiness. Without such a will, we're like a boat without gas. We can't make it to our final end. There's no motivating love, no drive, no yearning that compels us towards that far shore, despite all of the trials and tribulations that we're sure to face along the way. So, as we think in the last section of this lecture about Locke's views on what it means to reason, to seek, to know, and to understand, we should ask ourselves, how might such a view of thinking and of understanding affect our will, our personal agency, or our desire for the good? Does it obscure from us our vision of that far shore? Does it deny that far shore's existence, like when Columbus ventured across the oceans, while others feared there could be no far shore, that the world was flat, and that he might fall off the edge? That reminds me of a Bugs Bunny clip. Let's see.
She's around, she's a perma, she's a fully packed. She's around the back of my head. She's flat like your head.
Flat like your head, Columbus. Flat like your English flathead, Locke. Does Locke's view of things tell us, perhaps, to give up on such a journey of the spirit as a... Oh no! That's a crazy sound. Let me get rid of that. There we go. And I'll get rid of this one too. Sorry about that, folks. Does Locke's view of things tell us, perhaps, to give up on such a journey of the spiritual, or of the spirit as hapless, as a fruitless, deluded task? And if we're asked to give up in this fashion upon what has been intimated for thousands of years now as our greatest happiness, if we must relinquish our hopes of ever knowing being or what is our true first principle, then what kind of education is this that we're advocating in our schools? Can it truly be an education for liberty and for happiness as Locke might have it? Keep these questions in mind, ladies and gentlemen. Anyway, to begin with this last bit, let's turn to the introduction of Locke's Essay Concerning Human Understanding, where he tells us the meaning of his use of the word idea. Quote, "Before I proceed on to what I have thought about this subject, namely human understanding, I must here, in the entrance, beg pardon of my reader for the frequent use of the word idea, which he will find in the following treatise. It being the term which I think best serves to stand for whatsoever is the object of the understanding when a man thinks. I have used it to express whatever it is which the mind can be employed about in thinking." Okay, so just to be clear, whatever you're thinking about right now, Locke calls that an idea. The word idea becomes, in his writings, a kind of catch-all phrase for a wide variety of things you might hold or experience in your mind, like memories, images, concepts, percepts, thoughts, feelings, sensations. No matter what the object is in your thinking, that's an idea. And by thinking, Locke also means a diverse array of things, like perceiving, remembering, imagining, reasoning, feeling, sensing, judging, conceiving. All these are mental activities, eh? They're all heaped together by him under the common rubric of thinking. Okay, that sounds simple enough, but then it starts to get weird. Because when you or I, say, think of that cup of coffee we're drinking, all we can think of, says Locke, is the idea of that cup of coffee. We can't ever think of the cup of coffee itself. That is to say, when you or I have an idea about something, we suppose that it's actually an idea about something. Meaning that we sloppily suppose that the idea we've had, like the cup of coffee, has a real-world referent. That it's related to something real, something existent, to some aspect of being, something substantial that in thinking about the idea or in using the idea as a tool, we seek to know, right? Well, not for Locke. He says that sloppy thinking. We really don't know anything about that real cup of coffee. We don't know if there is one. All we know is the idea of the cup of coffee. Put another way, all we have in his view are ideas that have no object or real world referent. Or at least, if they have an object, we sure as hell can't know anything about it, right? You can't disprove or prove the existence of the cup of coffee, right? You just can't know anything about it. All we can know is the idea as it comes into our minds, and that always happens by only one of two ways, says Locke. How's this idea get in our melon? Either it's derived from our senses, like you smell it, right? You taste it, you feel the heat off the cup of coffee, right? Or it's something that comes to us by means of reflection. Okay, so senses and reflection. When our minds turn back upon themselves and think about all the stuff that's been pouring in through our senses, that's reflection. Locke's emphasis on how all knowledge pretty much is grounded in the senses and in sense perception is why he's known as the father of empiricism. So say I want to know your boot. I look at your boot. Ooh, shiny. I get all the percepts of sensation, and that's what I know just fine, but I don't know anything about your boot itself. Only the percepts are up there in my head, see? Not your boot itself, although I'm pretty sure I've had a few students in the past who would have liked to have been responsible for that state of affairs. Kind of reminds me of this sketch by the comedian Emo Phillips, where he's talking about an encounter he once had with his father after having returned from his first semester of a college philosophy course so many years ago. I'm going to play that for you now. No Looney Tunes this time. Let's see here. There we go. Emo. Oh no.
I had an argument with my father. I argued that Plato was the father of philosophy. My dad takes the opposite position, that I should wax the kitchen floor. I said, well, the kitchen floor doesn't exist. At least not in the permanent sense that the concept floor does. He said, do you think the concept your skull exists? I said yes, and then he surprised me by juxtaposing the two concepts.
So you see how troubling this is? Essentially, Locke is saying that we're wholly cut off from the knowing of the real world, from the reality of things, from each other. We can never know anything but what's up in our own heads due to our sensing. And all that's up there are ideas. Whenever we try to talk about the real or the essential, what is the substance or being? Well, that's just a load of hooey, Locke. Really, it's just us misinterpreting or falsely extrapolating something we suppose to be the substance, when really, it's just a complex of misunderstood ideas we've hammered together out of the simple ideas we've derived from sensations, and then maybe reflected upon in our minds. So any metaphysical language we use is pretty much a load of hooey too. Just a bunch of false concepts, errors, words that we've cooked up to name things that don't exist. Or rather, Locke says, maybe such things do exist, but you'll never know. You can't know either way, so why bother? And then, another weird thing about all this is that if we can't know anything but our ideas, those things up in your head and up in mine, well, you've got your head and I've got my head, and never the two shall meet, right? So, how is it that any of us ever communicate with one another? If there are no real world reference for both for our words, right? Let alone for our ideas, how can we ever talk about common experiences or share meaningful words with one another about our common participation in reality if everything we might speak about is only just up there in our own melons, necessarily cut off from all that is not up there in the old cranium? It reminds me of that bad poetry by Jim Morrison that I used to really dig when I was a teenager. I won't come out. You must come into me, into my womb garden where I peer out, where I can construct a universe within the skull to rival the real. Wow, far out, man. And Locke didn't even need to be high on acid or anything. Anyway, to be fair to Locke, he himself knew that this was all pretty dumb. He wasn't unaware of how ridiculous his claims about knowledge and ideas and thinking are, but rather than saving us the trouble of having to read all this nonsense, he wrote his big book, Concerning Human Understanding, anyway. And I get that, in a way. Sometimes a person has to get a thing off his chest, but then, if ever you shave the time out of your life, which you'll never get back, by the way, to read his book, you'll see just how ridiculous and self-contradictory and botched it is. It's actually a pretty lousy piece of philosophizing. It's like Locke was trying to make a jug to hold water or something, but after he was done, he realized the jug had all kinds of holes in it, which he then opted to plug with scotch tape and cotton balls. Take, for instance, his main claim throughout this whole book, that all we know are ideas, that we cannot know any object to which our ideas pertain. Well, recognizing how ridiculous that is, Locke sneaks into his book how ideas come to us via the senses, in this case percepts, and the percepts, they're of properties, right? And the properties are of real world things. What? How is he allowed to say that after having just said over and over again that we can't say that or make such assumptions about real world things? This waffling happens many times throughout his book, ladies and gentlemen. At a certain point in book 4, Locke seems to totally backtrack, saying that, yeah, regarding our simple ideas gained from impressions upon our senses made by percepts, as well as complex ideas gained from putting together these simple percepts and chains of reasoning, we can know these ideas are connected with what is real, and that they hit upon substance. But, in the same breath, he then goes on to say that the only ideas we can't be sure connect with what is are those we actually use to refer to, wait for it, reality. And then he goes on ad nauseum to use words to talk about having no ability to talk about reality. And yet he's talking about reality and how we have no ability to talk about it. Locke's fudging is frustrating to me as a reader. And it's funny because in the past, when I was an undergraduate student, I remember my professor telling me I couldn't reason for shit. And yet here I am wishing this guy who, as we've already seen, wrote voluminously about how much he digs reasoning, would actually do some reasoning for a change. Bertrand Russell advises us to simmer down in our frustrations with Locke in this regard. Russell is no slouch as logician, that's for sure. But he points out that being a good, consistent thinker wasn't really Locke's concern here. In his view, Locke, quote, aimed at credibility and achieved it at the expense of consistency. Most of the great philosophers have done the exact opposite, unquote. That's a pretty forgiving statement by Russell, I think. Here's another point on which I'd like to grumble. Locke contends that our words can only talk about our ideas, right? That's all we can speak about. And they can't be used, at least properly, to refer to substance, to essence, or to real being in the world. Except, of course, says Locke, their significance must agree with the truth of things, as well as with men's ideas, unquote. Ah! Again, I find myself saying, at the end of all those pages, why did I bother when this guy just goes round in a circle like this? Our words can't be signifiers for a reality beyond our ideas. That's what he says. Our words, but then he says our words must be signifiers for reality beyond our ideas. Blah, blah, blah. Locke, he just can't decide what he wants to say, and he seems to lack the courage of a genuine philosopher to explore and to plumb the depths of an idea honestly, regardless of its consequences. Okay. One final comment I'd like to make before ending this lecture on John Locke. I want to consider what he means by the word understanding. In chapter 2 of the fourth book of his big essay, Locke ponders what he calls the degrees of our knowledge. He adopts the classical distinction between two kinds of knowing here. One he calls intuitive knowing, the other he calls demonstrative knowing. Intuitive knowing is that sort of knowing we do when our minds just immediately grasp the truth of a thing. We don't have to talk it through or go through a chain of reasoning to figure out what's what. Like Van the Man sings, it ain't why, it just is. Right? In ancient times, and in the medieval church, philosophy, this immediate grasping of truth by the mind was known as intellectus. Okay, so immediate grasping, intuitive grasping, was called intellectus. By contrast, when our minds operate in search of the truth by means of discursive reasoning, wherein our knowing isn't direct, but rather indirect, because it moves from point to point to point, this form of knowledge Locke calls demonstrative. As we've seen earlier, he links this sort of knowing with what we do when we offer up mathematical proofs of a thing. Whereas intellectus was the term ancient and medieval writers used to name the direct, intuitive sort of knowing discussed just a minute ago, they used the term ratio to name this discursive mode of thinking. Locke rightly notes that we don't just do one and not the other, we do both. Both are weaved together. Even when we are reasoning discursively, whenever through our reasoning we come to an aha kind of moment, or whenever we begin to reason about something and seek a foundation to do so, we rest upon or light upon a moment of intellectus. As Locke points out, quote, each step must have intuitive evidence. Now, in every step reason makes in demonstrative knowledge, there is an intuitive knowledge of that agreement or disagreement it seeks with the next intermediate idea, which it uses as a proof. For if it were not so, that yet would need a proof. Since without the perception of such agreement or disagreement, there is no knowledge produced. If it be perceived by itself, it is intuitive knowledge. If it cannot be perceived by itself, there is need of some intervening idea, that's the point-to-point-to-point stuff, right? As a common measure to show their agreement or disagreement, by which it is plain that every step in reasoning that produces knowledge has intuitive certainty, unquote. Ordinarily, we translate intellectus, or what Locke is calling here intuition, by using our English word, understanding. Recall that Locke's entire treatise is entitled An Essay Concerning Human Understanding. Okay, and Locke sees that there is an important distinction between intellectus and ratio. And that's good. And he also sees how the two are part of our ordinary thinking and integral to how we come to know. That's also good. But if Locke is talking this whole time about understanding, then what is it that he thinks human beings come to understand? The answer here is quite simple, I think, ladies and gentlemen. We come to understand ideas and nothing more. How simple ideas are similar and different from one another, how they fit together to form complex ideas, that's it. We do not come to understand reality. Whereas Locke uses the traditional ancient distinctions between intellectus and ratio, he distorts their meaning in a most confused way. Let us remember from other lectures in this series, this contemplative gaze, that is the seeing of the intellectus, isn't just a seeing of ideas or concepts, ladies and gentlemen. The intellect seeks its beloved in being. It longs to know being itself. And the genuine philosopher seeks to know what is, just as all human beings seek to know to a greater or lesser degrees, like Aristotle says. Intellectus attends lovingly to knowing substance, to knowing essence, to knowing reality. Consequently, whatever it is that Locke is calling understanding in his book is certainly a far cry from what the ancients would call intellectus, or the human understanding. Mortimer Adler wrote an interesting book called 10 Philosophical Mistakes. I highly recommend that you read it sometime. In fact, read it instead of reading Locke's big essay. Save yourself some precious time. In his first few chapters, Adler takes up some of the bad mistakes that Locke has made and that we've inherited from him in our Western philosophic tradition. Interestingly enough, the most foundational of all modern-day errors Adler attributes to Locke. This error, as he calls it, is to suppose that we are directly aware of the contents of our own minds. You'll have to read the first chapter a few times to start to get the gist of Adler's criticism of Locke's claim that all we ever know are our own ideas. But, drawing upon Thomas Aquinas' Summa Theologica, Adler wants to say that we actually are never aware of our ideas in the way that Locke suggests. That the whole of Locke's epistemology ought to be flushed down the toilet, essentially. Remember, Locke the empiricist wants to say that we know only by sense experience and by extrapolating reflectively from sense experience, right? Moreover, he wants to say all we know are our ideas, or those things that enter our minds as the impressions of percepts. However, Adler contends that we don't experience our percepts, but rather the things perceived by them. Put another way, we experience perceived things, like out there, the cup of coffee, for instance, right? But never the percepts whereby we perceive them. You don't experience the idea of the cup of coffee. You experience the cup of coffee. Let me quote Adler, and you can rewind this section to your heart's content to try to figure out what the hell he's talking about. Quote, "We remember past events or happenings, but we're never aware of the memories by which we remember them. We can be aware of imagined or imaginary objects, but never the images by which we imagine them. We apprehend objects of thought, but never the concepts by which we think of them." Unquote. That's wild, eh? Essentially, Adler is saying that we're never aware or conscious of the memories or the images we call to mind, only the objects of those memories, only the objects of those images. Does that make your brain hurt like it makes mine hurt? Anyway, Adler goes on, quote, "A cognitive idea like a memory or a percept or an image or a concept cannot, at one and the same time, be both that which we directly apprehend and that by which we apprehend something else," unquote. So, maybe it's like when you or I sit down to read a really amazing, beautiful book. Or, say, when you sit across the table from someone you're falling in love with. You're just immersed in the depth of the story, or in the depth of their eyes, sucked in by their beauty and mystery. You lose yourself, don't you? You disappear. You're in that deep, deep place of intellectus, in the ancient sense, that intuitive contemplative beholding that is a direct union of seer with what is seen, of lover with what is loved. Genuine studium, as we've discussed it, is like that too. You get lost in your books or in your study. Time slips away. You slip away so beautifully and imperceptibly and miraculously. Such liberty and freedom. You and the object of your study are one. You and your beloved are one. But the spell is instantly broken when you fumble, when you become self-aware. When you get greedy, or in your pride, you attempt to watch yourself doing all that. When you say ridiculously to yourself, "Look at me being such a badass studier," or "Look at me appreciating this beautiful beloved of mine." Pop goes the balloon, or the bubble, or whatever it is. You can't do both those things simultaneously. That is, you cannot directly apprehend what is, and at the same time, watch yourself in the act of apprehension. Similarly, it seems that Adler is saying you cannot, as Locke supposes, become cognizant of your idea of door when you're thinking about door, which is the object after all of your thoughts. If all this sounds rather confusing, I think that's because it is confusing, ladies and gentlemen. If Adler's articulation of Locke's first fundamental mistake is difficult to follow, maybe rest in the knowledge that his error in this regard, Locke's error in this regard, has to do with his misunderstanding of intellectus, of how intellectus concerns only percepts and our ideas, but never the reality perceived or the object represented to the mind by the idea. In closing, I submit to you that these Lockean errors do not simply have consequences in arcane discussions that occur only in academic circles. I suggest, like Locke, that when our minds are not helped to become aware of the noblest and best truths, nay, when in modern post-Lockean times, we're actively discouraged from pursuing the relation between truth and reality. For is not truth the truth because it says what is? When we're swayed from seeking after the summum bonum, when we tell ourselves and our students that they are forever exiled from this their true beloved, from ever knowing what is their heart and mind, what it is their heart and mind most deeply desire to know, that is, from knowing reality. When we say or imply by our own suppositions such things to our students as their educators, these lies invariably affect not just their intellectual understanding, but also their willing. Being discouraged from ever questing after knowledge of the depths and heights of things, the ground of things. What does this do to a young person? How does it serve their happiness? Where happiness is, as Aristotle defined it, the excellent activity of the best part of the soul in relation to its most sublime object. Thanks for listening.